Thank you so much, Dr. Sid, for that wonderful, wonderful introduction. The actual words that you told me when I left was that I'm on loan to Detroit, and when I'm done, I can come back. So, first, good morning, my beautiful people. I've been waiting for a long, long time to talk to you. My first few months, when I first came to Ann Arbor, I went to Dr. Swift and I asked her to make a presentation to you, which you're going to see today. And she wasn't so sure, and I don't blame her. But we have so much to talk about. Here we are today, 4 years later, to do this presentation for you. And I just wanted to say a few things before we get into the presentation about my experiences here in Ann Arbor. And I've worked in many, many different organizations, which you will see later. And I haven't worked with a better group than you guys. And all of you have the children's interest at heart all the time. All the decisions that we make, we have that lens. Is this better for kids or not? And we need to have that. I'm not sure why I was asked to talk to you today, besides me asking for it, because I'm very direct and I'm very blunt. So what you're going to hear today is my opinions, and so I'm going to hold harmless Dr. Swift, cabinet, and you know who put me up here. So, and I've been given the liberty to say whatever the hell I want to say. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Honestly, I cannot wait to share my thoughts with you. And you better be nice to me. Because this is special for me too, because it's the first time I'm presenting and my wife is in the audience. So, if you're not nice to me, you're not getting paid tomorrow. Just making that clear. All right. So, the name of the presentation is Thoughts from a Funny Looking Guy. And so why did I name it like that? And the reason is that everybody claims me, but my people don't. And a few years back, I went to Mexico, and people there spoke to me Spanish. And, you know, they obviously thought I was from Mexico. A few years later, I went to Egypt. So people there were always speaking to me in Arabic, and I do look like I could be Arabic. So on the same trip, I went to Israel. And they strip searched me, and they wanted to throw my behind in jail, because they thought I was Palestinian. And then when I was in Cyprus, my homeland, and then immigration wanted to learn why I was speaking Greek so well. They thought I was Turkish. And you know Greeks and Turks, how well they get along. We want to kill each other, right? So who am I and why should you listen to me? So, like Dr. Swift mentioned, and cabinet, they wanted a different experience for you in this administrative retreat, the instructional council retreat that we're having over here. So they asked a business guy, an introvert, someone who's blunt, to come and talk to you If I were you, I would question their sanity, why they would do that. So you're taking a huge risk with me, but I'm sure it's going to be worth it. So those are Dr. Swift's and Cabinet's expectations, that you hear my story, but my expectations are basically, I want to touch your heart. That is my expectation when we're finished with this presentation. So I'm going to talk a little about leadership a little bit, but I'm also going to talk about myself and my experiences and what has shaped me. So who am I? This pretty much sums up where I came from. Obviously, I was born in Cyprus. One of my parents was from Africa, and one of my parents was actually from Cyprus. I have been through war. I was, and I still am, a refugee. And for part of my childhood, I was homeless because the Turks took our home, and they still have our home. We lost everything. I've served in the military. I was educated in Cyprus. I also went to school here for my bachelor's and master's. I finished at EMU. How many people are associated with EMU? I always hear about U of M. I always hear about Michigan State, but I bet you there's more people that went to EMU here, right? That's right. How many are Hurons? All right, how many are Eagles? All right, half and half. Too old. All right, so I speak obviously Greek and English, and then the trilinguals, because there's a dialect that is a Cyprus dialect, which even a Greek person does not understand when us Cypriots talk about it. And my first language was French, but I forgot to speak French, but I'm sure it will come back to me someday. So Angela and I, between us, have 5 children, and we have 2 of them in college. So that's why we both work, right? So you see some of the other jobs that I did, but my aspiration really is I just want to be like Carlos Santana, right? I just want to be just like you, right? I'm just like you guys. So now let's talk a little bit about leadership. Let's talk about the light. And all of us need to have this light. And in Dr. Brown's presentation the other day, there was a teacher. That was a video that he showed us. And in that video, the teacher talked about differentiation of instruction. And she said, if you're not practicing that, then you're in the wrong profession. So do you think she has the light? I think she definitely does. And Dr. Brown, he also talked about, I think he was answering a question, what do you do with people who don't want to do this work? They don't want to be engaged, right? And what was his answer? I help them transition to a new occupation, a new endeavor. So we are the light. You are the light in your buildings. We are the light in the district. So this equity work that we're getting engaged on is the light, and we have to carry it. We know we have inequalities in our system. And year after year, we get the data, and now is Now is the time to fix them, right? Now, and if not us, then who? Right? So, but when you sit back and you realize what has to be done, it's almost trying to achieve Mission Impossible. If you choose to take this mission, right? So choose to take this mission, because this is like a higher calling. This is very, very similar to engaging for safety of our kids. This is one of those callings to basically have a non-discriminatory system. Who wouldn't want to work for that, right? So we got to have the light, and we got to have it now. This is exactly what we want to do. We want to stand out from any other system, and we want to let us shine, right? We want to show our light. So how are we going to do that? You have some talent in your schools. We have some talent in our own building, our balance. But really, what is talent? So we have people that find, you know, things, they can do things that nobody else can, and they can do it easily. But I think it's much more than that. I think they make the people around them better. I think they're part of a team. They work with other people. And it is our job to find talent and to keep it and to train it and to support them and make them successful. And you know who those people? What those people are called to me? They're called geniuses. So doing the impossible things to keep your talent is, in my mind, genius. Because without talent, we cannot be successful. And the sooner we realize it, that we're all in this together, along with our teachers, and they need to come along with us. And it's going to be a bumpy ride. But this is the right thing to do. That's where I come in, brutally honest. And people that work for me, or my wife, or people that work with me, they know this is what I believe. That even being silent is even worse. So, we're not going to be silent anymore, right? You guys are very, very quiet. So, this can go in multiple ways. So, in many ways, it's how you manage. And we should manage with goals. We should manage that at the beginning of the year, we should set goals for everyone that works for us. And those goals should be tied to our major mission. And if our strategic planning is equity, then those goals should be associated. So those goals need to be measurable so you can measure them. And then those goals need to be discussed with the employee. This is what we expect, and then they get some input, and then at the end of the day, we have agreement. And then based on that agreement, it's like a contract. And then during the year, every so often, we meet and we talk and see how things are going. And if things are going well, great. If things are not going well, then we'll talk about it and see what we can do to get back on track. So that's how I feel about this honesty. And there are going to be people who are not going to want to abide. And it's up to us how to deal with that. And I think we got a pretty good idea from Dr. Brown's presentation. If we want to go east and other people want to go west, then they might have to get off the bus or get off the train, and we might have to unload them. So they have to be done timely. Those evaluations have to be done timely, and they have to be true, they have to be honest, and then we have, and we'll support you, but you have to do the right thing. We have to do the right thing. Conflicts, oh. We get them every day, right? So there's a huge probability that when we engage in this work, we're just going to probably increase the amount of conflicts that we are going to have from, I think, multiple areas, because there's people that are entrenched in traditions and they don't want to change. There's also people that are going to see changes that they might not agree with. So we're going to have to be ready, and we have to be, basically, we have to have that compass to guide us. So when we do have those conflicts, that we have to make sure that our conscience is right. That's the only way that we can navigate through these waters, is that our conscience has to be right. So do you guys believe that we're engaging in the right work? I couldn't hear you.
Yes.
All right. So, is your conscience in the right place? Do we believe that we want a system, we aspire to have a system that is non-discriminatory, that every child achieves?
Yes.
That, again, you guys are, did you have your coffee this morning? Anyways, so one of my things is that I try to do in my life, in my professional life, is to simplify things. And by simplifying things, then you make it easier for people to be successful. We need to simplify things. We need to, and then by simplifying things for parents, for example, make it easy on them, then they would choose us. If we make it easy on procedures that we have for our staff, they will stay with us. So it is, in my mind, this is a very, very important concept to think about simplifying, making things easier for us. A lot of times you hear, you know, we work hard and we're not getting the results, or working smarter. So if we simplify things, I believe we can be much, much more successful. This is a tough one. So how do we get better? Right? So you can't focus on 20 million things, right? You got to focus on the main thing, right? And we already said what our main thing is now, right? So to me, that's what takes priority. And I'm going to say some things now that you guys might not like, but I think it needs to be said. Academic achievement is the main thing. We need to understand that sports is not the main thing. We need to understand that band, all those things, it is not the main thing. Main thing is academic achievement for every child in our system. And all our focus, our money, resources, then it needs to go there first. So every school does something well. So that's, like Dr. Swift said, we need to focus on our strengths and just play to our strengths. That's what good teams do. You can't really change the world if nobody knows you, right? And Dr. Swift is the biggest example. She's everywhere. She knows everybody. She doesn't stop. And she's amazing. I don't know where she finds the energy to be everywhere. And we need to follow her example. And this is just some examples that we need to do all the time, that we need to practice with our parents, with our kids, our teachers, between us. And some more examples. So we need to get out in the community and be part of nonprofit organizations, be on their boards, those kind of things, so people know who we are. So now we're going to get to the part of, you know, of a personal story. So everybody has somebody who they look up to, someone who has helped them along the way, or someone who has inspired them during their life. And a lot of the times, it's one of our parents, could be a celebrity. So in my case, it's my mother. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about it today. And so you get to know her a little bit, and then you get to know me a little bit. So my mom was born in Africa. And her dad was from Cyprus, and her mother was from Africa, and she was born and raised in Africa. And my grandfather owned a general store, and he was in the jungle, basically. So, so my mom, in order for her to go to school, she had to travel by car in those days, about a week to get there, and a week to get back. And there were six of them, and she was the third child. So there were three boys, three girls, and she was the second girl, but the third child. So when she went to school, she didn't come back until summertime, because they had to stay all year, and she went to school. And it was run by nuns, the school. So it was a Catholic school run by nuns. So when she finished elementary school, she had three younger siblings. And my grandfather wanted her to stay in the elementary school and take care of the younger siblings. So she went to sixth grade three times. so she can take care of her younger siblings. And then when she was 15, my grandfather took all four children and sent them to Cyprus. So here you'll see that's a picture of four of the kids and my grandmother and my grandfather. And the other two kids were already, the older kids were already in Cyprus. And I don't have many pictures of my family because of the war and so forth, but I have some. And then here's my grandfather with the four kids when they're on a boat somewhere. So when they got to Cyprus, my mother went to another boarding school, and then she finished. She wanted to go to college. She was very smart. And so my grandfather would not send my mother to college. He already sent his son to college, but he wouldn't send his daughter to college, even though she was like close to top of her class, and she wanted to be an artist. And money wasn't really an issue for my grandfather. So instead, my grandfather arranged for my mother to get married so she could take care of her younger siblings. So my grandfather would have, like, over a 3-week period, a family come with their son, prospective groom, to my grandfather's house, his family, my grandfather's there, and they have dinner, and then they try to see if there's a connection. So the next week, it's somebody else, and the next week, it's somebody else. And then at the end of the 3 weeks, my grandfather asked, "You have to choose one." Well, he didn't ask, "You have to choose one." So this is the story my mom was telling me. So I asked her, so how did you choose? And she goes, "Well, I didn't know him from Adam. So I just chose the prettiest one. He had green eyes and good set of teeth, so." That's my dad. But that's their engagement, and then there's their wedding. So my mom was this genteel artist type of person, and then my dad finished third grade. But he was very nice and genteel too. But you can obviously see that there could be differences, right? But my dad was very good with math. So he was able to manage businesses and so forth, even though he had a third grade education. So when they got married, they already had two kids, the younger siblings of my mom until they became of age. And then they had three kids of their own. So I'm the oldest one in this picture. So, but this is just the background. So my mom, like I said, she wanted to be an artist, and she never got the chance to go to college. But she continued to study on her own. She continued to take classes, whatever she could, you know, and she continued to practice and improve because she had that light in her. So what I'm going to show you in just a second are just pieces of work that she's done that she gave to me. people out. That's the good part about it. So a few years back, I got a call that my mom was not feeling well. So I have a sister that lives about an hour and a half away by flight in Athens in Greece. So she went and visited my mom, and then they called me. And they said, I can be here a couple of weeks if you can come in a couple of weeks. And then my other brother, who was in California, can come the next 2 weeks, and then we can rotate. I said, okay. So I took a flight and went to Cyprus when it was my turn. And as we learned a lot more about my mom's condition, the 2 weeks turn out to about 2.5 months. And the my job was getting very patient with me. So they were calling me to come back or I wouldn't have a job. So I after 2.5 months, I went back. And then before I went back, I arranged for my family to come and basically to say goodbye, because it was pretty clear my mom was not going to make it very long. So when we were saying goodbye, we pretty much taped it so we would have something. So what I want to share with you is about a minute of that goodbye, and it's in this segment, it's pretty much my mom talking to my son, who is at the time 14 years old. So I just want to share this segment.
Students have a very high place, help a later. People who are suffering, understand?
Yes.
Help in your life, people. Don't be an egoist, looking at yourself only, to have a high place only, but try to love everybody, to help many people. Understand? To have a good heart for everybody. Don't look the color, don't look the nation. We are all one. Understand, Demetriou?
Yes.
We are all one in the world. And this is the best, because you can love everybody. Mm-hmm. You understand? Everybody can love. If you love one nationality, you will not be happy.
That's right.
But if you love everybody, you'll be the most happy person in the world.
It's true.
You understand? And Katerina too?
Yes.
I wish you to be a very...
So basically, what she was saying is I think a lot of the things that we are trying to accomplish, and I think she was giving directions to my son, but I think she was giving directions to all of us. And I try very hard to model what she was saying. And just by showing you this, I hope that all of us will live by these directions.